to those who are online and watching from home. You know, worship is a collective moment. You know, worship is a time where we can exalt and praise and sing out to our Lord. And the two sweetest things, actually the three sweet things about worship is, one, you get to worship God directly. Two, you get to be in His presence. But three, we get to do it together. You know, everyone's been to WizKids concert, you've been to Burna Boy's concert, everyone has come together, but there's no greater concert. There's no greater time to sing. There's no greater time to dance. There's no greater time to come together in an atmosphere, in an ambiance, than it is right now to worship. So for those of you who are willing to and are able to, then I encourage you, come to the front as we gather together, as we worship, as we sing unto the Lord, in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. That was a bit weak. I haven't stood here for a while, but the fact that I am, I give glory to God. But that hallelujah was too weak. It's not for me. So when I say amen, I need a better hallelujah than that, church, okay? Amen?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
We're giving glory to God. We're giving glory that is due unto His name. Hallelujah. So wherever you are in the building, whether you're at home in your living room, you're sitting in your bed underneath the sheets, please take them down. Shake yourself. Let's give glory to God. Amen. This song simply says, I love you forever. The lyrics are very simple. And when I look at scripture, like John 3:16, the Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Romans 5:8, for while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen? I don't know what kind of love that is. And I know a lot of you are waiting. Some people could be waiting for tomorrow, Valentine's Day, Galentine's Day, Mandem Times Day, whatever times day that it is for you. Whether you have a bae, a boo, a hubby, a wifey, a link, whatever you have, please, let's not have links in Jesus' name. But whatever you have, I know that the greatest love is the love of our Father. He died for our sins. Scarcely would a man die, and He died for our sins. So I'm saying all of this because when we sing the song that says, I love you forever, I want you to think about why we're saying we love Him. Why do you love Him? Doesn't He deserve your love? Hasn't He shown you enough of His love that you can give Him the glory this morning? So I want you to get involved. Please do not just be silent. God likes your voice. If someone's told you can't sing, God likes it, okay? So let's lift our voices. And I want us all to praise Him and give Him glory. I love you forever. I love you forever. I love you forever, Lord. I love you forever. I love you forever. I love you forever, Lord. Lift your voice and say,
I love you forever. I love you forever. I love you forever, Lord.
I may make mistakes sometimes, but I love you.
take the honor. I just want to say thank you. Can't get the glory, you get the praise. Take all the honor. I'm so in love with you. You're beautiful, so beautiful. I fix my eyes on you.
Oh,
is ministering to you a word for the church. The Lord speaks all the time. And if he's ministering a word that you need to share, don't hold back. Come and see one of the ministers and deliver that word in Jesus' name. Oh, oh, we worship you, Lord. You're so worthy, so worthy, so worthy, so worthy, so worthy. Oh, are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Holy. Are you Lord? Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, you are holy.
Holy,
Lord,
holy,
would just say thank you. Sing, you get the glory.
You get the glory. You get the praise. You take the honor. I just want to say thank you. You get the glory. You get the praise. You take the honor. I just want to say thank you.
Yes, Father, Lord. Lord, you take the honor. You take the glory, O God. We worship you, Father. We magnify you, Lord. We glorify you. Just continue to praise him. Continue to worship him. Exalt him with all your might, Father. Lord, we worship you. We magnify you, Lord. We thank you, Father. Family, if you could all just join me as I say this prayer. Let's say it collectively, Lord. Let's say it collectively. Our Father, who art in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. Oh, Father God. Lord, you forgive us of all our trespasses. You forgive us of all of our sins. You forgive us of all of our iniquities. For yours is the kingdom. For yours is the power. For yours is the glory. Forever and forever. Oh Lord, you deserve it all. We worship you. We honor you. We magnify you. We glorify you. For you are Alpha. You are Omega. Father, we praise you. We love you, Lord. So family, after the count of three, I just want every single person here, every single person online, to scream out, I love you, as we scream out to the Lord. After the count of three. One, two, three. I love you. Praise him, family, praise him. Thank you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you. We thank you. Amen. Amen. Family, you may be seated. Family, you may be seated. Good morning to all of you who joined us during our praise and worship. And good morning to everyone watching online. And welcome to our Sunday service. Can you just turn to the person next to you and just tell them, I love that you are here. And turn to the other person on the other side and just tell them, I love that you are here. And if you're at home, do the same with your family. And if you happen to be by yourself watching online, then I love that you are watching from home. Because you didn't have to be here. You could have chosen to stay at home, but you chose to be here. You chose to click on and stream online, and you chose to say yes and accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. So I love that you guys are here, and I love that you're here with us and we get to fellowship together. So this is the second Sunday of our newest theme based upon John 13, 34. A new commandment I give you. Love one another. As I have loved you, love one another. You know, the concept of love would not have been alien to the Jews or to the people, because they had families, so they knew what love was. But what made it a new commandment, a priority commandment, is the type of love that God was talking about. That unconditional love. And in just in case we weren't sure what he was talking about, he then gives us a comparison. As I have loved you, love one another. And we know that God's love is sacrificial love. So as we spend this month just learning about love, learning about God's sacrificial love, his unconditional love, his agape love, I want all of us to really take in, you know, every word of encouragement, every teaching, every preaching. Let's really learn. But as well as being hearers of the word, let's also be doers of the word and try applying every single teaching that we receive. At this time, I just want to call up the guest ministry. If guest ministry, Faith, if you'd like to come up and just greet our new guests. If we can give them a round of applause, please, Faith and Lydia. Come on, guys, we can do better than that. Let's encourage them. Let's encourage them. In Jesus' name.
And we are part of guest ministry.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Woo! Okay, so I would like to welcome everyone who's here for the first time. If you're here for the first time, put your hand up so that someone can see you. If you're near anyone that's here for the first time, please let them feel welcome. We have one there, one on the top, two at the top there. Please clap for them. Woo! Welcome to Ark. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, and we do hope that you continue to come and join us again.
Yeah, and if you're new and you want to just talk afterwards, please find me and Faith or Michelle, who's at the back. Yeah, have a great service.
Take care. Well
done. Thank you. And if you are joining us for the first time online, then can I just ask you just to enter into the chat? It's your first time. Everyone else watching will greet you, and there's an email as well, so we'll just try to reach out to you and get in contact with you as well. We have an announcement, so if the media team, if you want to play the video and then play the second update video afterwards as well. So if everyone can just turn your heads over to the screen and we'll just watch our announcements.
Good afternoon, family. We pray that you're having a blessed Sunday so far. Our announcements for this week are as follows. Join us at the Ark Forest Gate on Friday the 18th of February for a night of prayer and intercession hosted by the Ark Praying Parents and Ark Intercessors. This night is an appointment with God, so please come prepared for a deep dive into prayer. Come along and submit your prayer request, and let's join our faith one with another as we petition God for our churches, families, communities, and nation. We look forward to seeing you there. It's not too late to sign up for the Spark to Life Holistic Mentoring Course. This AQA accredited course will empower you and equip you to be a culturally competent mentor to a young person. Participants must be available to mentor a young person in their community on a voluntary basis for a minimum of 6 months. Please scan the QR code to register. Registration closes on the 16th of February. The young adults at Forest Gate are going for a weekend trip to the popular Big Church Day Out Worship Festival from Friday the 3rd of June to Sunday the 5th of June. The price per person is £115, which includes travel and hotel stay. Please approach anyone from the GAP or Princess team for further details, as spaces are limited. On Friday, the 11th of March at 7 p.m, the GAP will be hosting an open and honest discussion on church hurt. If you've been impacted by the pain of church hurt, or believe that you have something to share that will inspire the healing and restoration process for someone else, then please make sure you save the date and attend. Here ends our announcements for today. Thank you for listening and enjoy the rest of your Sunday.
Hi there, it's Joseph.
And Naomi.
Yeah, and we're messaging in from California. We did a message last year, and so we're in our second year here now at BSSM. We thought we'd just do a little update. So how's it been?
Amazing! Second year is totally different from the first year. In the first year, we focused so much of school on like identity, knowing who we are in Christ. And then this year is all about like activation, leadership. So we've been going out on ministry trips. We're getting ready for some really exciting missions trips. So going to sow into supporting local communities in Hawaii.
I'm going to Alaska.
Total opposites. But yeah, it's been awesome. It's been really, really good.
Yeah, we've been activated a lot more this year. As someone who's kind of done evangelism for a number of years, I feel like for a long time I was just sowing seeds and not always seeing the harvest and the fruit. And then God showed me at the beginning of the year that I was like a vision of seeing the harvest, seeing fish and fruit coming in. And since then I've been out seeing so many people coming to know Jesus, deliverance, set free, healing.
He's baptized a lady in a bath.
I knocked on the door and spoke to her and she got baptized. That was really cool.
Great.
And then, It's just been so cool to see that happen, right? And to be walking in that.
And for me, it's been a little bit different. I've still been doing some evangelism stuff with Joe, but also in the evenings, I've been working back in the UK, leading a course with business leaders across different organisations in the UK. Mm. And it's been incredible just to see, like, just by sharing the love of Jesus with them, without even speaking about faith, but just to see how radically they've been impacted, how hopelessness has just dropped off, how there's just so much joy, contagious laughter, tears, just peace. Each one of them in their Zoom screens encountering the love of Jesus, just in a radical new way.
Yeah, you don't have to be on a pulpit with a microphone to be a revivalist. Wherever you guys are being sent out, you can bring revival.
She's
been seeing that. And we've had a really powerful move of the Holy Spirit here at church in America at Bethel. And actually, it's being led by the children. God has just been forward, like, moving in with the children. Children have been, moving in such power, prophecy, praising with all their heart. And so they were sort of brought that into school. And it was just amazing to see in their childlike faith and them demonstrating childlike faith. And so we just pray for the children of today that that your families just get radically touched by the Holy Spirit. That there is no such thing as a junior Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit can touch anyone, even an infant, even a newborn infant, as we saw in the Book of Luke, right, where the baby, even the baby in the womb was praising God. So yeah, we just pray for that for all the children right now, that it'd be a revival sparked from the young children right now.
Oh,
in Jesus' name.
Yeah, we love you guys. Yeah, we can't wait to see you when we're back. Please keep us in your prayers and we'll update you again soon. Take care. God bless.
Wow. You don't have to be on the pulpit or have a microphone to be radical for God. Joe and Naomi, if you are watching, we love you guys back. Thank you so much for the update, and we look forward to seeing you both next time you're down. So our theme this month is love. Everyone say love. Everyone say love. Everyone say love. And as Daniel said, everyone loves love. Everyone loves, you get all gushy, you get all mushy, and even the guys that try being hard and tough like Ben, deep down, look at him smiling. Yeah, he's smiling. We all love love. Everyone say love. Love. So this month we're talking about what love is, what does love look like, and how we can express that love. So I'm going to call up a few people just to kind of share what does love look like in their circumstances. Without further ado, if I can just call up Ryan and Nadine, if you guys can come up, give them a round of applause as they share what love looks like.
Morning, everyone.
Morning. Okay, so love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude.
We love because he first loved us. Let all that you do be done in love. Okay. And he who finds a wife. Okay, shall I say that again? Okay. He who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. Okay, so thank you very much, Jason.
Thanks, Jason.
For allowing us to be up here. Yeah, we blame you this morning, by the way. But thanks. But we love everyone here. For those of you that don't know us, I'm Ryan.
And my name's Nadine. And we've been coming to the Ark for around probably 8 years now. We've been each other's lives for 17 years, but married 8, and we have 4 beautiful boys in our marriage. Sorry.
Why are you nervous?
I don't know.
Don't you love me?
I'm so nervous.
You love me, don't you?
I love you, but I'm very nervous.
That's fine. You should be nervous. Okay, that's fine.
Okay.
Right, go on.
So going off our theme of this month, in our marriage, we've learned to grow in our marriage, to grow in being patient with each other, which is a hard thing.
Hard,
sometimes.
It's very hard.
We've learned to be kind to one another, and also having God at the center of us, being able to just, you know, speak to God about how to keep going in our marriage as well, and it's really it's been important for us.
One thing for us, obviously, we're married, and one thing that we did on our wedding day in front of so many people, and most importantly, in front of God, is, for those of you that are married, you would know your wedding vows. So part of it says to love and to cherish until death do us part. That's part of the vows that we all would say in front of so many witnesses, in front of our loved ones, and most importantly, in front of God. Like my wife said, that we always put God in the center of our marriage. Anything that we do, we thank God for. We thank God for each other. We thank God for our lives. We have an open door policy in our house where we invite other couples into our house, and just literally just talk to them and fellowship with them. And we've had some joys with them as well, laughs and sadness, and yeah, but we love. And that's the main thing, I think, for us as well, is by setting an example for what we do, not only for the people that we invite into our lives, but also for our families. We've got family members that are not married. We've got family members that say they're not getting married. They don't believe in that married thing. We're not doing that. And also for our kids as well, we've got to set an example for them as well. So hopefully that one day they will find a beautiful young woman to marry. And we've got 4 boys, so all this church, there's so many women in here. So we've got 4 boys. Okay. So
we're also,
but they're not old enough yet, by the way.
Okay. We're also a part of the Married for Life team here at the Ark, which is led by a beautiful Sam.
Woo-woo, Sam. Woo-woo. Yeah, and everyone else that's in the team as well.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's us. That's our
little
love story. There's loads of us. So if you want to come and speak to us, or that's fine. We've got. We could probably tell us.
We could tell you our long story.
But we're still in love.
Really? Can we give a round of applause? They didn't look like they were reciting their vows at the beginning of that. There was a moment where I saw Ryan looking into Nadine's eyes, I think, oh my goodness, what's about to happen here? Before you guys go off, if you don't mind me asking, very, very, very quickly, can you both give a quick example of what the other partner does or has done for you to know that they love you? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So just one short example, just one thing where you know, yeah, he loves me, yes.
She's allowing me to play the PlayStation. Simple as that. No joke, I'm not going to beat around the bush.
Okay, I'll go off of being the PlayStation. For me, Ryan has had to, in our vows, we had about our health. And I've actually been through 7 blood clots.
I've had 3 miscarriages and obviously our pregnancies. And through that time, you know, love has really been an example, because Ryan has stepped in and been the best husband that he could ever be. You know, he's really carried me through. And when I've had those low moments, he's always been there to pick me up and just to keep strong in my faith, to know that God is there as well. And, you know, as hard as it can be, especially having so many health problems for me, he's been my stone, because I call him a stone. He calls me his rock, because he's always a stone for a way.
Okay. Wow. Can we give them a round of applause?
Yeah, okay. So, one more thing, just, I was on the way here and I heard a part of something in the car, but it actually made sense about today. And I was listening to the first part of the words and it made sense why I love my wife, why God loves us. And it goes, there is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
One more time. Give them a round of applause. Give them a round of applause.
There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for eternity long and find there is none like you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Give them a round of applause. I think there's going to be a fifth son. Goodness me. Goodness me. So that was beautiful. So 2 examples of what does love look like, reciprocated. For one is sacrificing their quality time. The other one is just enduring and being there. So we now want to call up another individual who's going to share what love looks like in their relationship. But we're not talking about marriage this time, but we're talking about sibling relationships. So if I could just call up Shimon, just to come up to the stage and just share what love looks like for him.
Morning family. Yeah, so as Grady was saying, it'll be very different to what was just shared. But yes, love as a sibling. I think as many growing up with siblings will know, there's just a lot of bickering and arguing that can happen. But I think the first thing that I think of when I think about love between my siblings and myself is food. It's good food. So my mum is an amazing cook, and she taught all of my... So I've got 9 siblings, first of all. But I grew up with 5 siblings in my house, 6 boys my mum was raising. And she taught all of us how to cook. One of us, Shafiq, who comes to ARC, he's a chef as well. And yeah, so we all grew up learning how to cook. But Shafiq especially has made certain meals where I've enjoyed it so much that I've just said to him, I need to hug you. I need to hug you because this is so good. And that's what I mean, that I feel that love that he put into the food. But I think the other thing that probably comes out the most in our love is banter. So something Danielle has noticed since she's been in our family group chat is we just send memes all day. Like, we're just always sending funny things, which is new to her. It's different to what she's used to. And that's what we'll do. But what I've found, I think as I've been thinking about this as well, is a lot of our banter, although it's good to have banter, a lot of it has kind of been at the expense of each other, which sometimes is nice. But I think Something I'm trying to do anyway is to change my way of loving my brothers. I'm trying to be intentional about doing that. So rather than at the expense of the other one, so that other people will be laughing at them and they'll be embarrassed, my love for them now is to try and almost in the ways that I can disciple them and to teach them the ways of the Lord, and also to be there for them and actually grow a connection with them, because I found that a lot of our conversations would just, again, it would be about laughing and joking. And as Pastor P knows, I'm a very direct person. We're all very direct. We're very confrontational, but it won't be in that sense of like having those proper deep conversations about life and more importantly about the Lord. And so that's something I'm trying to do more of. And also with my amazing wife, to show a godly marriage to my brothers as well. So show that form of love, what it looks like to love someone in a way that is pleasing to God. And in general, as a disciple of Christ. And yeah, that's all I had to say, really.
Give him a round of applause. Give him a round of applause. Thank you for that, Shim. I love that you gave that quick shout out to your wife. Baby number one. Amen, amen. One thing I love about what Shim just said, because he spoke about, you know, love being expressed through a friendship. And he shared how, you know, they already love one another through their banter. And that's how they express their love and how they show their love. And they all appreciate it. But he's now at a point where he wants to develop that love and take it to the next step. And that's by having more intimate, more direct, more conversations, and through that expressing the love of God as well. Because obviously sometimes, you know, when we're loving on someone and they know they appreciate it, we keep that love consistent because it works. But then growth is always good. So Shim kind of acknowledging, actually, I can take it that much further and that step further. So that's a beautiful thing, Shim. And if anyone doesn't know, Shim's brother's upstairs. He was blushing whilst Shim's brother's upstairs, and he was grinning his teeth. I told him to come down and he was shy and embarrassed. But if anyone wants recipes or if anyone wants anything, then Shafiq is right there. Shafiq, if you want to wave, we can check your Instagram page and we know who you are. Everyone give Shafiq a round of applause. He's being shy. So a question I want to throw out to every single one of you, and I'm going to give you guys around 20, 30 seconds to answer with one another. The question is, what does love look like to you? Is love to you sharing the last piece of chicken? Is love to you waking up in the middle of the night when you're tired, you've had a busy day, but waking up to speak to your friend who's having a really difficult time and sacrificing your sleep? Does love look like to you when you have, you know, £100 and you really want to buy this outfit or you really want to buy this thing, but there's someone who's really in need because their enemies are getting close, so you realize that you want to give them the £100 instead? What does love look like to you? So I'm just going to give you guys just 20, 30 seconds really, really quickly. If you're at home, then type in through the chat, what does love look like to you? Go, 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 go. Go for it, go for it, go for it. What does love look like to you? Amen. Let me bring you back. Amen. So Axel and I were just talking about, you know, what does love look like for ourselves? And one of the things that we both mentioned is that love is sacrificial. So it's putting someone else before yourself. And that could be really, really difficult because you might need something or you might want something, and it's putting that to the side in order to be there for them, in order to help them, in order to love upon them. But what makes it even more difficult, which makes love even sweeter, is the fact that they may not acknowledge your sacrifice. They may not acknowledge your act of love. But the whole point of love is to put them first. So even if they don't acknowledge what you've done, even if they don't necessarily take you on board, even if they don't necessarily thank you for it, you are still doing it for them, because it's not about you, it's about them. And that is how you can show love and you can sacrifice your love. So at this time, I just want to call up our praise and worship team. We're going to go into a time of offering, of giving. There are three ways that you can give. The first one is by direct bank transfer, which is the most appreciated way, if you can. Second is through our Church Suite app. And the third is just by giving cash envelopes. Praise and worship, you can come up. So if you need an envelope, if you could just wave your hands and the ushers will come over to you. If I can ask everyone to please stand up on your feet as we go into a time of giving and as we go into a time of worship. In Jesus' name.
God bless you all. Oh my gosh. I know I'm not hearing in one ear, but can you hear me? Oh, okay. So God bless you all. All right, forget you guys dancing. Up top, no, to my right. God bless you. I'll bless you too. You guys in the front, God bless you. Okay, you to my left, God bless you. Okay, I can't really hear with this ear, so I'm not going to really take it. God bless you guys. And everybody at home, God bless you. Hallelujah. Come on, musicians. Everybody come and clap your hands. Because God is faithful, amen. Okay, amen. Is God faithful? Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey. Lord, we love you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Lord, I glad.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I love.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you came.
One more time, Lord, I live
your name on high.
Lord, I live.
Come on, give God some praise. The devil tried to knock me out, but I got back up. Hallelujah. He thought I was down and out, but I got back up. Knocked me with COVID, but I got back up. Knocked my heart, but I got back up. Now, devil, I'm ready to fight the fight of my life. Touch your neighbor and say, I'm ready to fight. Come on, give God a shout of praise. Woo! You may be seated. Hallelujah. God is good, eh? Praise God. It feels good to come and preach again. Thank you, Lord. It's good to see you all. Thank you all so much for your wonderful prayers. Week, they robed me up and gloved me up and celebrated. Amen. And I thought, you know what? Let me come out today with my robe and my gloves. Thank you, Lord. So I want to say, I've said it again, and I'll keep saying it. Thank you so much, everyone, for all your support, all your prayers, all your words of encouragement, affirmation. I think without that, I just would never have made it. One of the whole highlights of being in hospital was, you know, because I couldn't have visitors the whole time being there, apart from the first 4 days. But there was one day in particular where I got a call that said, look out the window. And I looked out the window of my hospital room. And in the distance, I saw Lydia. I think you were the first one I saw, Lydia. And then there was a group of maybe 15 of them from here, including Karis, that came outside my hospital room with placards saying, we love you, and sang praises out there and prayed out there. And I had to wave a little white hanky for them to know what window I was in, because it was so far away. But from the window, I was able to hear them praying and hear them singing, and it was just so encouraging. Amen. Thank you guys for that. So I am so excited about God's love, and thank my family, and appreciate also Jason, Grady, MK, TJ, Steve, Joelle, and all the leadership team for just standing in the gap while I was away. Come and give them a hand. All of those of you guys that serve in ministry, you know what I would like today? All of you guys that serve in any capacity of ministry, you're in leadership in ministry, please just stand right now. Just stand if you're serving in a ministry capacity as a leader. And I'd like everyone here, please give all of these guys a big hand. Just celebrate them. Praise God. All right, you may be seated. Just before I preach, Caitlin, could you come a minute, please? Just 1 second. I know you preached the other day, and I was watching you from online because I couldn't be here. But while I was watching online, I was just, you know, I realized that they missed something, didn't they? So, Caitlin, can I see your... What is that? Can you zoom in on that thing there? Huh? It's too big already. Yeah. This is a big stone. Could you explain to us what's happened?
Hi, family. So yeah, I'm engaged. Oh wow, I always feel so awkward doing stuff like this. I'd rather preach. So I got into your courtship with my lovely fiance Philip about 3.5 years ago, and this past December that just went, we went over to Accra in Ghana with his family. He's currently based in Nigeria, and we went over to Ghana, which I thought was for his birthday celebration, but it was actually for my engagement. And on one of the days, I thought we were going to a really like lovely cocktail party with some people that they knew out there. So we got all dressed up, but he actually took me to a rooftop overseeing Accra that he had decorated. And yeah, he proposed to me and asked me to be his wife.
And what did you say?
I said yes.
It was so beautiful to be able to actually be zoomed in on that and be able to pray for you guys that day with my weak, breathless voice. I was so excited. We're really excited for you. We bless you and Philip for a wonderful future to come. Come on, give her a big hand. Bless you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. So please turn your Bibles to the book of John, chapter 13, verse 34 to 35. And also, if you can, Galatians chapter 5 and verse 6. Praise God. It is really lovely to see everyone. Praise God. It says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Verse 35, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, by the way that you speak in tongues. Sorry, let me read it again, sorry. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, by the way you cast out devils, by the way you prophesy. By this shall all men know, Rocky's gone, that you are my disciples by your excellent preaching, if you love one another. Turn to your neighbor and say, if you love one another. The world's going to know we are the disciples of Christ by how? By the way that we love one another. Galatians 5 verse 6 says, for in Christ Jesus, or in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision means anything nor uncircumcision, but faith which works by love. Amen. Everyone say, faith which works. Faith which works by love. Circumcision means nothing. Uncircumcision means nothing. But what really means something is faith that's working through love. There was a lawyer who's a newspaper columnist and a minister whose name was George Crane. He tells of a story of a wife that came to his office full of hatred towards her husband because I'm sure of the things that he was doing. And she says to George, I don't just want to get rid of my husband. I don't just want to divorce him, but I want to get even. So before I divorce him, I want him to hurt. I want to hurt him as much as he has hurted me. So Dr. Crane suggested a real ingenious plan. He says, go home and act as if you really love your husband. Tell him how much he means to you. Praise him for every trait, every good trait. Go out of your way to be kind, considerate, generous as possible. Spare no efforts to please him, to enjoy him, make him believe that you love him. After you've convinced him of your undying love and that you cannot live without him, Then drop the bomb on him. Tell him that you're getting a divorce. That will really hurt him. So with revenge in her eyes, she thought, man, that sounds good. She smiled and exclaimed, beautiful, beautiful plan. He will be so surprised. And she did it with enthusiasm, acting as if for 2 whole months she showed love, she showed kindness, listening, giving, reinforcing, sharing. And when she didn't return back to Dr. Crane, he called her up and says, are you ready now for that divorce? She said, never. I discovered that I really love my husband. Motion resulted in emotion. Everyone say motion resulted in emotion. So I want to speak very briefly this afternoon on the subject of love works. Turn to your neighbor and say love works. Say love works, love works, love works. When everything else will fail, and we can try all the different things that we want to try to get our world to trust Jesus and to believe in Jesus and to receive the gospel, we can do all the gimmicks and all the games, and we can put on all the spectacular and the supernatural and all of that. It comes down to the only thing that Jesus said is really going to work is love. He says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. Because he says, what profits if we give our bodies to be burned and we don't have love? It profits nothing. If we have faith to be able to move mountains and we don't have love, he says it profits nothing. He says, if we prophesy and speak with tongues, he says, we're just noise, clanging sounds, tinkling cymbals, the Bible says. Just a lot of noise if we don't have love. See, the only thing that's going to work is love. Touch your neighbor and say, love works. Love worked for God. You know, God, who has more power than all of us, is confronted with a world that hates him, a world that is against him, a world that's violating his commandments, being just, you know, whatever to him. God's plan was to love. God so loved the world that hates him, the world that is against him, the world that violates his commandment, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God's idea to save the world was love, because God knows love works. It was love that causes God to give his son. Calvary is the greatest act of love you will ever see. I mean, we get gooey and mushy when we heard, you know, Ryan and Nadine talking. But come on, when we talk about Calvary, when we talk about the love of Jesus on that cross, whilst men were hating him, whilst men were spitting at him, while they were beating him, he still had that love. The Bible says, for the love, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, despising all of the stuff that was coming at him. And they threw all their hate at him. You know, if you think about it, you know, there's a song, I don't even remember it. What if God was one of us? What if God was one of us? What if God actually did come down in human form and walked among us? How would we be towards him? I think people would like to believe that they would just, you know, but what happened when God was one of us? We spat in his face. We put crown of thorns upon his head. We nailed him to a cross. We jeered him. We mocked him. We did all of the evil, wicked things that could be. 1 minute, Hosanna to the Son of David. To the other minute, crucify him. Crucify him. But through it all, Jesus just kept on loving. So what makes the commandment of love a new commandment? Because it's an old commandment. Love has always been there. Love was there in the Old Testament. So what makes it a new commandment? What makes it a new commandment is that little addition to it. As I have loved you. I share with my leaders, and maybe I've shared it in preaching here, Remember many years ago when we was over in Romford Road, God challenged me about love. He says, do you really love? I mean, just, you know, when God asks you a question, he already knows the answer. I mean, you know that, right? And the question is really to expose something that God's trying to give you a revelation of. And it's generally not something you want to actually hear. So he asked me, so it's like when he asked Adam, where art thou? It's like God knew where Adam was. He just wanted to know if Adam knew where he was. So God says, do you really love? And I said, I thought, yeah, I love. How many, if God asks you, do you love? Would you say, yeah, you love? So I said, I love God. I love. And then God said, so if Judas was doing to you what he was doing to my son, like he was stealing money and he was about to betray him, like, would you still love him? Like, God really challenged me. Would you have washed Judas's feet knowing that he was going to betray you? I'm like, hell no. Would you still love Judas knowing that he was stealing money from you? Because actually it's quite easy to love people that are loving you, right? It's easy to love people that are encouraging you. It's easy to love your husband when he's nice and compliant. To love your wife when the shop's open all the time. Can you still love? Can you still love Judas? Just ask your neighbor, would you still love Judas? I'm telling you, God asked me this question many, 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 many years ago, but I've not still got to that place where I could confidently say, yeah, I love like that. It's like God set the bar so far and showed me, like, you've always got to be stretching yourself in love. Stretching yourself in love. Because when you think you're there, you're not there yet. Touch your neighbor and say, you're not there yet. He says, love one another as I have loved you. So when I often think about God's acceptance of me, his salvation of in my life, him coming into my life and using me. Think about it. Using me now. You know, God is not using me because I'm perfect. Did you know that? And he's not using you because you're perfect. Actually, you're quite jacked up. Look at your name and say, you are a mess. If they don't believe you, tell someone else behind you. Tell them, you're a mess. We're all a mess. Please, tell somebody else you are a mess. But the amazing thing is that God still loves you and he still loves me and he accepts me. Think about it. He knew Peter was a mess. Upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. Thou art Peter. I mean, he is affirming Peter. He knew Peter was going to, a few days later. Who is he? I don't know. I've never seen him in my whole life. And many people get onto Peter's case. And I'm not here defending Peter because his name is Peter. Although, Peter's a great name. It's a great name. But everyone gets onto Peter for denying Jesus, don't they? Like, everyone knows that. But think about it. When Jesus was going through all of that court and being accused and whipped, the only one that was near proximity of all the disciples near to Jesus was Peter. Mind you, he was warming himself by a fire, but where were the other 11? So the only reason why Peter was in a position to deny Jesus was because he was around. Because he had said to Jesus, I'll never betray you. I'll always be here. I'll go to prison with you. Jesus says, yeah, that's what you think. I know you love me, Pete, but your love's not quite there yet, son. You're actually going to deny me. God, Peter says, never. Not me. John, yeah. Matthew, yeah. Thomas and Judas, not me. Everyone say, not me. Peter said, now you're going to, before the cock crows three times, you are going to deny me. And Peter did. He denied even knowing Jesus. That's like, I mean, that's like someone, one of you, Grady, turning around tomorrow. I don't believe in God anymore. I don't even believe Jesus was Messiah. And that's what he's going on with for a few days. I don't believe in God anymore. Yeah. And he's, yeah, in a few days, 50 days later, God is still going to use him to preach to 3,000 people and they're going to all get saved. Just a few months later, God's going to use him and his shadow is going to heal people. Just a few days later, God's going to use him and the Gentiles are going to get swept into the kingdom. I'm telling you guys, most of us would have given up on Peter. Like Peter would have been dismissed, his faith is over, especially with this cancel. Come on, you just kick a cat now. Sorry. I'm really afraid for this generation. This cancel culture is weird. Like, they just... Anyway. Thank God God doesn't cancel us, eh? Look at your neighbor and say, you're not cancelled. Jesus says, love one another as I have loved you. If we can demonstrate that kind of love that Jesus demonstrated in his love for Judas, in his love for Peter, in his love for his disciples, in his love for the people that were hurting him and shouting at him. If, you know, I often think about Jesus on the cross, suspended in the air, in agony and pain. People are ridiculing him. If you're the Son of God, come down. Look at you now. Where's your God? And jeering him. And Jesus on the cross says, Father, forgive them. For they know not what they do. Now I'm like, they know full well what they're doing. Isn't it? When people are hurting you, like in your head, you've made the whole plot. You've done an episode series of why they're doing it. They're doing it on purpose. It's because they're jealous, bad mind. They want this, they want that. And you make up a whole scenario. There's nothing in your head that's like, they don't know what they're doing. For us to be able to really hate them, we need to believe that they really know what they're doing, right? Your husband didn't say good evening when he come home. He knows what he's doing. It's on purpose. And doing it on purpose. The pastor walked right past me on Sunday. I know there was 300 people in the room, but he walked right past me. He didn't even say praise the Lord to me. And then the pastor's preaching to 300 people and he says this in his sermon. It was talking to me. Yeah, because like the pastor sits down and he prepares his whole sermon just for you. Purpose. Jesus said, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. If they knew what they're doing, they wouldn't do this. If they knew, they wouldn't hurt me like this. Amen. So Jesus said, love one another as I have loved you. Then in John 5:17, he says, Jesus answered them and says, my Father is working and I am working. Jesus is saying, everything I see the Father do, that's what I'm doing. So just the way Jesus says, love one another the way as I've loved you, he's saying, I am loving you the way I see the Father loves you. So he's saying, I am mirroring the actions of the Father. God so loved the world. Amen. I'm mirroring the actions of the Father. Now I want you to mirror my actions. The way I love my church like that. The way I love the people of God. The way I love sinners, love them like that. And when people drag people and throw them down and demand law and demand justice and demand stoning, do like I do. Raise up that woman and give her a dignity back and send her on her way. Go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn thee. Love one another the way that I have loved you. Hallelujah. You know, in the early parts of our marriage, I was always bringing strays home. Poor Karis. Serious. I was so zealous, like, I'll pick up people off the street, bring them home, give them a room, feed them, clothes. We would go out to work, me and Karis, would come back home. Kitchen will be disgusting one of these occasions. Like jam all over the place, breadcrumbs everywhere. Like just, we've gone out to work and we come home to this. And man, we were just loving on this particular individual, just love. And this happened a few times. They came into church, they got saved, you know, brought them to the Lord. It was just helping them out. A few months down the road, they got very spiritual. There's no love in the church. I'm like, what? Serious? No love in the church? I'm telling you, I wasn't saying, Father, forgive them. I really wanted to slap. I felt Peter Nemba, not the saved one, the other one, rising up. No love in the church. I am the church. Can you see, brethren, when one of us loves you, the church is loving you. So if Jason don't come to the hospital, but Nicole comes to the hospital, the church is loving you through Nicole. So don't say there's no love in the church. Look at your name and say, love one another. He says, as what my father's working, and I'm working. He says, I must do the works of God while it's day. There's coming a night when no one's going to work. Ladies and gentlemen, it's daytime. It's time to work. God is at work and he's in the work of restoration. He's in the work of healing. He's in the work of deliverance. He's moving up and down, trying to seek and to save the lost. And he said, love one another the way that I have loved you. Can we love like that? Thank you, Lord. Mark chapter 12, verse 30. The Bible tells us that we are to love God with all of our hearts, with all of our mind, and with all of our strength. Amen? God wants you to love him thoroughly with all of your mind, with all of your intellect, all of your thinking. He wants you to love him with all of your mind. Look at your name and say, love God with your mind. To love God with our minds means we have to protect our minds, especially from this present evil, wicked generation. We've got to protect our minds. I'm not saying don't watch the news, but don't get consumed by the news. Protect your mind, guys. A lot of it is just worldly propaganda, hatred, and then sometimes we just sound like the world. We start condemning people because the news and the TV is condemning and we join in and we echo that when we should be loving. Amen. So I'm not saying don't watch the news. I'm just saying protect your mind. Everyone say protect your mind. I'm not even here saying, now we grew up devil vision for no man. It was a kind of misconstrued on the scriptures. You know, when Jesus said tell the vision to no man, they turned it around to devil vision to no man or television to no man. So they preach against television and watching TV. I'm not here doing that. But I'm just saying that as believers, we have to protect our mind. And we have to love God with all of our minds, love Him thoroughly, think about what we're thinking about what we're watching, what we're allowing into our minds. Because we're watching these episodes and seasons. And I'm not here saying, please, don't go away, say, I said I'm preaching against it. I'm just saying, just be careful what's going on in your head. Be careful about the messaging that's constantly going, because you're going to find that if you keep on just filling your head, and you're reading one psalm a day to counteract three seasons of scandal or how to get away with murder. You've seen enough men kissing. That one scripture you're reading, I'm talking about two men kissing, like you've seen all of that. And then your little daily devotion is supposed to counteract. It ain't gonna work. Look at your neighbor and say, ain't gonna work. Love God with all your mind. Come on, touch your neighbor and say, love God with all your mind. Love Him with all of your heart. God wants us to love Him passionately. Hallelujah. I said, God wants us to love Him passionately. And don't let nobody play down your love. Don't let nobody ridicule your love. Love God with all of your heart, with every fiber of your being, with every bone in your body, with every cell in your body. I just find it quite interesting that people can be passionate about so many things in the world, and they'll give all their time to practice whatever field they're in and whatever they're doing. But the moment you begin to give passion to the things of God, people are telling you, you're going to burn yourself out. You're going a bit too far. You know, you need to calm down. When I got saved, that's what they said. Like, I was praising God like crazy. I've slowed down because I got a bit fat. But I used to be able to jump quite high. I don't get too far off the floor anymore. But I remember I used to be leaping. I don't know if you remember, Sister Lorraine. I could leap really high. And someone in the church saw me praising and leaping high. And they said, it's a demon. And it came to me that they said, it's a demon. And at first, it kind of discouraged me. But then I remembered the story of David when he was praising God, bringing back the Ark of the Covenant. And Michal was at the window. And she looks down. She sees David dancing out of his clothes and like Ben. And she begins to ridicule him. Look at him, shaming himself in front of all the maidens. Look at him. He's not even behaving like a king. Pastor's supposed to worship like that. You know, sir. And David turned around and said, you haven't seen nothing yet. Paul said, David said, it's going to get worse. I'm going to get even viler than this. Look at your neighbor and say, you ain't seen nothing yet. It's going to get worse. I said, it's going to get worse, because I'm to love God passionately. I said, I'm to love God passionately. We cannot afford to allow Arsenal fans, Man United fans, Liverpool, Newcastle people to love football more than we love Jesus. We should never be in a church where people are not crazy in love with Jesus. Nobody should have to force you to lift your hands, to dance, to come to the front, because nobody is doing that on the football terrace. They love football. They love football. They, in the freezing cold winter, they're naked, they got no tops on. Oh, no, that's not Arsenal, because that's a... and they're singing, and they're raising their hand. and a little lever round object goes between two wooden posts and they go crazy, crazy. Amen. But listen to me, when Jesus died on the cross and when he came back from the grave, and I know it was 2,000 years ago, but it's still real today. Jesus Christ the same yesterday. Every time a person gives their life to God, we need to see that like a goal and go crazy. Every time a young person or an old person or whoever gives their life to God, rather than sitting back looking and they're not going to last. Oh, let's see how long this one lasts. We've seen them come, we see them go. Shut up! Get up! Go away! Go away! Go away! Go away! Go away! Look at your name and say, he wasn't talking to you, he was talking to someone else. Just love God passionately. Love him passionately. Love him in prayer. Love him in his word. Love him through loving people. Love him in worship. Love his house. Love being in his house. Love being around his people. Amen. Love being around his people. I don't know about this new day, this new thing. Amen. But it's never going to be an old thing to gather ourselves together and come together in praise and in worship. Forget not the assembling of yourselves together. Amen. As the manner of some is, especially as you see the day drawing nigh. Amen. So get back into the habit of getting up on a Sunday morning, putting on your dress and your hat and your girdle. Your wig, your eyelash, you ladies have got more to put on. Some men are all putting on them things as well, like. But let's just get passionate about the things of God, amen? Because we've got a world to win. You know, while I was standing there worshiping today, God is saying there's a new wave coming. There's a next wave coming. We've been going through what we're going through because the devil knows there's a new wave coming. Think about it. For the time of this church, out of this church, out of you guys, some of you are new. Amen. Out of us, God has birthed 8 churches. Amen. That's all over the place, winning souls, doing things for God. God has used us, but there's more coming. God wants to use us mightily. He wants us to grow again. He wants us to blossom again. Somebody shout hallelujah. Love works. Love works. Let me get back. The love of Christ, 2 Corinthians 4, 5-14. For the love of Christ compels me, Paul says. I'm compelled by love. Why do you do what you do? Love. Why'd you get up early and pray? Love. Why are you fasting? Love. Why are you going out of your way? Why, Ryan, why are you opening your doors to couples? Love. The love of Christ compels me. It's not money. It's not fame. It's not fortune. Yes, some people are still chasing those things. And some people are still motivated by those things. But it's the love of Christ that's constraining me. Philip, why do you play the guitar? Why do you lead the worship team? Worship team, why are you meeting every Wednesday, all year round, practicing to come and sing? Why are you doing that? Love. It's got to be love, amen? You're doing it for love. You're not doing it for platform. You're not doing it for performance. You're not doing it for high praises. You're doing it because you passionately love God. Touch your neighbor and say, I love God. You don't love God? What's up with you? Some of you catch it. You'll hear it. When a man loves a woman, let me finish up. Genesis 29. When a man loves a woman. Genesis 29, 18 to 30. And Jacob loved Rachel. And he says, I will serve 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel. Laban said, "It's better that I give her to you than I should give her to another man. Stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel. And they seemed to him but as a few days because of the love he had for her. When you're working out of love, it will feel easy. When you're not doing it out of love, it gets tiresome. It gets burdensome. That's when you burn out. But when you're doing it out of love, 7 years, everyone say 7 years. When a man loves a woman, he will work 7 years for that woman. And the Bible says then, Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife that I may perform my duties, for my time is completed." So Laban gathered together all the people of that place, made a feast. But in the evening, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob. And he went into her. Laban gave his female servant Zipporah to his daughter, Leah to be his servant. And in the morning, behold, it was Leah. I've worked for 7 years and ended up seeing Leah sometimes. How many of you know what I'm talking about? It must have been very dark. She was veiled, I guess. But I'm sure that veil must have come off at some stage, right? Because I don't know. I mean, some people know. They will sleep all night with a man and wake up and don't know who it was. Or a woman. Behold, it was Leah. Jacob's worked 7 whole years for Rachel because he loves Rachel, and he ends up seeing Leah. So Jacob said to Laban, "What is this that you have done? Did I not serve you for Rachel? Now you've deceived me." And Laban said, "It is not done in our country to give the younger before the firstborn." Now, why didn't him telling that in the first place? Because if you know the whole story, you know, we talk about Jacob being the trickster. The real trickster in the Genesis is Laban. Man's using Jacob like tricking. Forever tricking him. He just held back information, didn't he, there? You know, I'll say to Karis, in my 33 years, is it 34 or 32? 33. In my 32, nearly 33 years, married Karis, she's never lied. She just doesn't lie. She just withholds truth. I'm serious. I'm really serious. She's never lied. Absolutely, you can trust. Even if she tried to lie, she couldn't. She's just not that way. She's just economical. So Laban withheld something from him. He didn't tell him that. And then he says, "Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also for return of serving me another 7 years." And Jacob did so. So he completed her week, that's Leah's week, and then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be his wife, and Laban gave a female servant Bilhah to his daughter Rachel to be her servant. So Jacob went into Rachel also, and he loved Rachel more than Leah, of course. And he served Laban another 7 years. He worked for Rachel. He worked for Rachel. 14 years of service. So what are, we just had Caitlin up. I could have asked her, what are the things about Philip that made you say yes to Philip? Because, you know, the portrait of a godly man. Look at your neighbor and say, the portrait of a godly man. Number one, he keeps his heart pure. Because there's lots of temptations all the time. And all the time, a godly man has got to learn to keep his heart pure. Even when all the temptations are coming at him, he keeps his heart pure. He keeps his mind sharp. Everyone say he keeps his mind sharp. Because a godly man wants to be wise so that he can make wise choices and wise decisions. No woman wants to be with a thick man. Some of you are going after thick men because their biceps are thick. But their head is thick also. As the Jamaicans would say, thick. Sharpen your mind. He's a man of integrity. Amen? Integrity that's integrated. His life is integrated. His soul, his heart, his mind, his life is integrated. If you meet a man and he starts telling you stories, and somewhere in the stories, the dots are not connecting. Have you ever heard someone telling you a story and like it's not, you're not getting the connection? So then you start asking questions. And why are you asking me so much questions? Because the dots are not connecting with this story you're telling me. This business that you had a million, that the business collapsed, and then you started another business, and you had this business partner, and then you look around the person, there's no friends. They've got no friends. You're thinking like, how does someone live for 35, 40 years and have no friends? There's a reason why someone doesn't have no friends. And you're about to find out. Integrity, everyone say integrity. The portrait of a godly man, he works hard. Jacob worked hard for Rachel. I know we can reverse roles, but and in a society we can have it where there might be times when the man's not working at time. But if there that opportunity, if that happens where you haven't got a job for a moment and your wife is working, find something to do in the meantime. And you know, you're at home playing PlayStation. And then Grady asks you, what do you love about your wife? She allows me to play PlayStation all day while she goes to work. I'm not talking to you, Philip. Like, that's not... Sorry, bro. Give me a high five. Everyone say he works hard. Godly man works hard. And he devotes himself to God. That's the next one. He devotes himself. A godly man is devoted to God. He's absolutely sold out, given over, devoted to God. And a godly man never quits. He's not a quitter. He'll keep trying. He'll keep trying. He'll keep trying. He'll keep going. He'll keep going. Quitters never quit. Amen. He's never going to quit. He's going to keep on trying. That's a godly man. So let's just be like Rachel. Sorry, like Jacob. That's going to work. Even if it's 14 years that we're going to have to put in labor. Let's work. In Jesus' name. And the last scripture I want to read is Genesis 24, 10 to 12, 10 to 22. It says, Then the servant took 10 of his master's, took 10 of his master's camels and departed, taking all sorts of choice gifts for his master. And he arose and went to Mesopotamia, the city of Nahor. And he made the camels kneel down outside the city by the well of water, the time of the evening. The time when women go to draw water. And he said, O Lord, God of my master Abraham, please grant me success today and show me your steadfast love. He said, behold, I'm standing by the spring of water and the daughters of men of the city are coming out to draw water. Let the young woman to whom I shall say, please let down your jar that I may drink. And who shall say, drink, and I will pour water also for your camels. Let her be the one who you have appointed for your servant Isaac. By this I shall know that you showed steadfast love to my master. Everyone say, by this. Before he had finished speaking, behold, Rebekah, who was born of Bethuel, the son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, came out with a water jar on her shoulder. Watch this, verse 16. The young woman was very attractive in appearance. Beautiful. Everyone looks at her. She was beautiful, stunning. A maiden in whom no man had known. She's a virgin. And she went down to the spring and filled her jar and came up. Then the servant ran to meet her and said, please give me a little water from your jar. Verse 18. So she rolled her neck. She put out her hand. Who do you think I am? Get it yourself. No. She said, drink, my Lord. And she quickly let down her jar upon her hand and gave him to drink. And when he had finished drinking, she says, I will draw water also for your camels until they have finished drinking. So she quickly emptied her jar through the, and ran to the well to draw water. And she drew all of his, she drew for all of his camels. Everyone said it was 10 camels. The man gazed upon her in silence to learn. He's just watching in amazement at this woman, whether the Lord had prospered his journey or not. And when the camels had finished drinking, the man took a gold ring weighing half a shekel and two bracelets from the arms weighing 10 shekels, and he gave it to Rebecca. Now, what we've got to understand, a camel can go 10 days without drinking water, but it's going to lose at least 40% of its body weight and fluid in that time. A camel needs to drink at least 40 gallons of water to replenish that. So when the Bible says this woman gave drink to these camels, don't imagine for a moment that she just dipped her little thing and said to the first camel, here, little camel. 40 gallons. That's 332 pounds of water for each camel. That works out to something like 3,320 pounds total for all of these camels. So just imagine for a moment, there's no running tap. She runs to the well. She goes down the well. She gets the water. She comes back up out of the well. She throws it into the trough and she goes back down again and she gets the water. She comes back up again. And she, until she's fed the first camel, that's the first camel. Camel number two, she goes back down. She digs, she comes back up. Hallelujah. I'm going to get to camel number eight, right? We're on eight, we skipped seven of the camels. Back up. And she throws into the trough. And it would take her, they say it takes a camel to drink this half an hour each to drink. And the Bible says when they had all finished drinking, remember she has to do this for each camel at a time. So we're talking here, not 10 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour. This is probably a whole afternoon of getting water and watering camels. In the meantime, the servant's looking and saying, wow, this is a wife for my master. This woman can work. Yeah, she can work. This is the one. Now, remember, the Bible says she was very attractive. That did not impress the servant. She had hips, lips, fingertips, but it didn't impress the servant. What impressed him was her level of work, her level of devotion. Have we got some women here that know how to water camels? Guys, don't marry lazy women. Do not marry a lazy woman. Remember, I told you that. So when you come and tell me she ain't doing this and that, I told you, do not marry a lazy woman. If she's lazy to work and do things, water camels and do things, she'd be lazy to have sex too. Because that involves work. Oh. I'm sorry. It's Valentine's tomorrow. That's interesting. But do we have some Rebeccas in the house? Come on, ladies, do we have some Rebeccas in the house that know how to water camels? Love works. Everyone say love works. This woman, she worked so hard in feeding these camels that the servant was so impressed that he took the gifts that he brought. He put a ring on her finger, bracelet on her hand, and he took her to his master. And she became the wife of Isaac. Amen. And got in the family line. He was looking for a woman that worked. She was beautiful, but that was not the thing that was impressive. It was her level of work. And same way, it was the level of Jacob's work in working for Rachel, amen, that got him his wife, amen. Now when you get Rachel and you get a Rebecca together, hallelujah, two people that know how to work, everyone say work it, amen. Two people that know that love works, that are gonna work on love. There's nothing more tiresome, amen, than one party in a marriage doing all the work, amen. There's trouble in the marriage and it's one party trying to get counseling, it's one party talking to people trying to get the marriage fixed, amen. It does never work like that. But when you have two people working, amen, working for their marriage, working for their relationship, working for their home, working for their children. Amen. Godly fathers, working hard fathers, amen, are working for his family, working for his children, working for his wife, and the wife is working for the home and working for the children, and together they're both working because love works, hallelujah. And when we work at love, amen, it's going to take love, amen, it's going to take work for you to love me. I'm hard to love. And so are you. You're not easy to love. Look at your neighbor and say, he's talking to you. It's going to take work to love. So when Jesus says, love one another, that takes work, guys. It does. It's not a gooey feeling like, Holy Spirit. I love you with the love of the Lord. No. It's more than that. It's going to take work. It takes going out of your way. It takes making sacrifices. Everyone say love works. The church, when we say, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples, it's not because we turn up on Sundays and we say praise the Lord to each other and we say quote Psalms and scriptures and say blessed and highly favored, the world's going to know. No. It's how we love one another outside of Sundays. It's how we think about each other, reach out to each other outside of Sunday. Sundays is easy. It's easy. Just dress up, put your hat on, your girdle and all of that, come to church. But after that's all done, when the music is faded and all is slipped away, I'll bring you more than a song. You know, when all of this is done, there's no worship team. That's when it all begins, guys. It's on Monday. It's on Tuesday. Love works. It takes effort. Now, this Facebook Messenger thing is easy. Like, you know, just like and tick. I love them because I love liked and tick their picture. Even though sometimes some of you are liking pictures, I don't know why you like it. Person's half naked and like, and you're a guy. Anyway, sorry. I'm sorry, I don't like pictures that you've got no clothes on, it's not like. So next, move on, just flip. You feel convicted, MK? But it's more than likes and it's more than follows, eh? It's dedication, it's hard work. Please stand with me. Love works. Love really works. if we would devote ourselves to just doing what Jesus said, in loving each other, working like Jacob, working like Rebecca, watering camels, Holy Spirit will gaze upon us in wonder. Look at them. The world would look and say, wow, what an amazing church. Look how they love each other. Thank you, Lord. I want to close this service with two things. I'm going to pray for those who may want to give their heart to the Lord. But before we do that, would you, not the person next to you, but maybe someone behind you, someone that you're not familiar with, would you just pray with them? You don't have to hold hands. You can if you want to. But just pray with someone you don't know is around you. And just pray for God to give you capacity to love on strangers and to love on his people. Just pray for them to be able to have capacity to love, would you? Just lift your voice and pray. Sebala hasi andala mahaya. Sebala buhotele mahaya. Thank you, Lord. Kepasotala mahaya. Fill this church with so much love, God. Fill this church with capacity to love. Help us to go out of our way in expressing honor. To go out of our way in expressing love. Help us to leave our comfort zones to express love, God. Ambahata labaha shehalaha ya kobo sibeti la mahaya. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Fill this church with Jacobs and Rebeccas. Consume us, Lord. Shed abroad your love in our hearts, God. That we would reach out, Lord, beyond ourselves. Kela mahasi ala mahayando lobo sianda. Kele mahaya la mahaya. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. 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 Joel, can I just borrow you a minute, please? Come on, stand next to me. I'm going to make a call, but I want to celebrate this guy here for a moment. Because Joel is a great example of a Jacob. And a fantastic example of someone that just keeps extending and extending and extending and just loving and thinking about and just being considerate about. And just may the spirit of Joel just be just multiplied in the name of Jesus. I wish some of you guys would just say to Joel, Joel, show me how to do what you do. Let me follow you. Come under your wings. I want to do what you do. I want to serve the people, love the people like you do. In the name of Jesus. Give Joel a big hand, please. Come on. Just before I close, if you're here today and you've never ever given your heart to Jesus, you've never said yes and invited Jesus into your life to save you, today can be your spiritual birthday. If you're here today and you have gone away from the Lord for some time and you wish to return to the Lord and rededicate your life, please just raise your hand if you want to say yes to the Lord today and ask Jesus into your life. Or if you want to rededicate yourself to God, we just want to include you in this last prayer. Is there anyone that wants to say yes today and invite Jesus into their lives? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I just pray your blessing upon this entire congregation. As we go into this week, Father, fill our hearts with love. Help us to love our spouses, love our wives, love our family, love our mothers and our fathers and our siblings. Help us to love our neighbors, to love our work colleagues, to love, Lord Jesus, people around us, to love people in our local shops, Lord, supermarkets, God, to love people on the bus and on the train. Help us not to be just caught in our own world, God. Help us to take out our pods from our ears and just listen and watch and observe and reach out to others. Bless this church, Lord, with capacity in the name of Jesus as we thank you in Jesus' name. Everyone give a big shout unto the Lord. It's been great preaching. I love being back and being able to preach again. Have a fantastic week. We love you in Jesus' name. Come on, hug someone, greet someone before you go. We're leaving this place at 3:30. Hug someone.